Welcome to the Songwriters Across Texas podcast. This state has a lot to offer, and music is one of its greatest exports. On this podcast, we get to know songwriters through their stories and hear some of their music. Today, we're at Arlyn Studios, and my guest is David Grissom. I'm Karl Anderson, and this is the Songwriters Across Texas podcast. It was always music. Very early with the transistor radio, quickly to vinyl. He started on drums, he heard the Beatles' Revolver, and switched to the guitar. A blank canvas being filled with Keith Richards, Hendrix, the blues, and jazz. For David Grissom, growing up in Louisville, Kentucky was as good a place as any, being a stopover town for tours. By the time he finished high school at the age of 17, he was ready to go. A five-week summer session at Berkeley proved a great experience. Then 1 year of music school in Indiana is where he met drummer Kenny Aronoff, and school was suddenly over. He went to Austin in 1983, where within a month he was touring with Lucinda Williams, next with Louie Ann Barton, then Joe Ely. Then he was playing with his drummer friend Kenny and John Mellencamp's band. He's had an astounding career as a guitarist, playing on many albums and tours, including Buddy Guy and the Chicks. But he has five CDs of his own, and he has a show playing at the Saxon Pub on Tuesday evenings that we've been enjoying for years. It's my pleasure to share that with you and welcome David Grissom.
Good to be here.
Life's a winding road. Bends and bridges, twists and turns. Time's a match in your fingertips. Strike it up and watch it burn. Once we found our shelter in the arms of the moonlight glow. Too many walks on fences. Too many I don't knows. And I wish you peace. Wings of love. And anything that you try, I hope you find the answers to the questions in your heart. May you be satisfied. Sometimes I feel like crying. Sometimes I wanna laugh. Hanging on to your memory like an old faded photograph. So many things I tell you if you were still around. I'm sorry that I hurt you. Sorry that I let you down. And I wish you peace. Wings of love. And anything that you try, I hope you find the answers to the questions in your heart. May you be satisfied. Of love and anything that you try, I hope you find the answers to the questions in your heart. May you be satisfied. May you be satisfied. Satisfied.
That's great. Is that a newer one or?
No, that's a song from a long time ago in my days of having a publishing deal in Nashville.
Mm-hmm.
And I would go up there and do records and play. I played on lots and lots of country records from about 2000 to 2010.
Right.
They weren't really country records, but they were kind of, that was sort of the phase where some of the records, you were really kind of influenced by the Mellencamp records from about 10 years before.
Right.
12 years before. And so I got recruited. And so I would go up there and play on records a lot. And in the meantime, met Frank Liddell, who's a great producer and publisher and knows songs, and wrote some songs with some of his writers. And then he signed me to a deal. And it was my first experience with Nashville co-writing on a regular basis. I mean, I'd written with people, but a lot of times writing with those guys, they would come to my house in Texas, and we would just sort of go out and see if there were any rattlesnakes, you know, in the backyard.
Right.
And in Nashville, they put you into these little cubby holes, these writing rooms, you know, where, like, you know, the moth-eaten sofas, and you can hear the people on either side of you writing their song, which is just a touch distracting. And it really is a blind date. You walk in and it's like, how you doing? And then you got to get all intimate and, you know, for 3 hours write a song with somebody.
Right.
But one day they, so there's this new guy in town, and we really want to hook you up with him. We think it might be a really good fit. He's pretty raw and pretty rocking. And so I went over there to the Seagale Publishing. We wrote at their place. And I walk in, and the guy says, hey, I'm Chris. He said, let's play each other a song. And I'm like, okay, you first. Nobody had ever done that before. It's like, you know, let's get right down to business. What you got? You got a title, you know.
Right.
And so he played a song for me, and it was like, I needed earplugs. It was like, his voice was so powerful.
Wow.
Chris was Chris Stapleton.
I was thinking it might go that way, and I was kind of
so
hoping.
That song I just played, we wrote together.
Great.
And we wrote about 8 or 9 or 10 songs.
Nice.
And it was before he was a household name, obviously. But I mean, it was like, you know, I wrote with so many great writers there. That was different. I mean, I could tell right off the bat, like, this guy's like,
well, he grabbed it right by the horns, didn't he?
Yeah, but I mean, he just has it. And he can see, as a writer, I've never worked with anyone who worked faster.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't like fast and let's get this over with. It was like focus.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, just like every other time you write a song with somebody, or not every time, because now in Nashville, there's like 4 people or 5 people that write a song. Like, you got the lyric person, the melody person,
really,
the chord person, the track person. quite often that's the case.
That's
ridiculous. But it was rare for me, at least. It wasn't uncommon for some writers to have 3 people in the room, but for me, it was rare that that ever happened. So, you know, sometimes I would have a lyric idea that I would bring in, and other times I would just have some chords. Once we found something that we both felt like had some weight to it, we wrote that song right there and was written in about half an hour.
Wow, it's a beautiful song.
Yeah, I mean, Rita Coolidge cut it and on her last record, and then I just produced a record for a guy named Mike Burris, and it was the only song he didn't write that he wanted to put on the record. So
that's cool.
Anyway, it was a really fun time.
Nice.
And Chris, you know, kind of watched him ascend, you know, and we would through Facebook or whatever, we'd send each other, hey man, how you doing?
Uh-huh.
Or I'd like, you know, and I could see his career picking up. He did the Steel Drivers, and then it looked like he was going to do a solo career, and I said, man, I'm really happy for you. And he goes, thanks man, thanks a lot. And then he was on the big night with Justin Timberlake when all hell broke loose, and everything, all his numbers changed, and I haven't talked to him since. You know, it's like he became Chris Stapleton that night.
He sure did. I could go down some more roads with you, like you being up on stage with a lot of powerful players like Buddy Guy and stuff like that. But I'd like to go back to your beginnings, because I think your story is so cool that you grew up in Louisville, which is really kind of the heart of this country.
Yeah, I mean, it was, I mean, now Louisville downtown has been reborn and revitalized, and there's all sorts of things going on. It was kind of, downtown was pretty bleak when I was growing up, but there were a few music clubs, you know, and I got a, I mean, there was no scene that I knew about. And so, I mean, early on in high school, I switched to guitar, like, as you said, after I heard Revolver.
Right.
And in very short order, I got with a guitar teacher who kind of took me through Sympathy for the Devil and House of the Rising Sun.
Nice.
And then Hendrix and stuff like that. And then he's like, no, man, you need to go take lessons with this guy because I can't teach you anything more. And he turned me on to B.B. King and Buddy Guy and Magic Sam, Butterfield Blues Band.
Right.
And then he says, man, now you got to go take lessons with this guy because I think we've kind of run the gamut here. And so then I got a teacher who taught, he was more of a jazz guy, and I learned to read a little bit and a lot more theory, and that has really served me well.
Right.
And so I was, you know, all of a sudden I knew about Wes Montgomery and Kenny Burrell and all these guys, and was learning these jazz standards. And so it was just, It was cool that, you know, back then, if you could swing it, you know, you would take lessons. And
right.
I don't know how much people do that as much anymore. It's like, let's get on YouTube and learn it.
That's true, yeah.
But I had to show up every week. I would get an assignment, and I had to work on it. But I really wanted to work on it. It wasn't like work, you know?
Sure.
But I did feel like I wanted to show up and make my teachers feel like they were succeeding.
You're a good student. But did you go, you told me that you would like learn one song at a time, right? And just then learn it inside out.
Yeah. And that was a real, when I look back on it now and I see, even now, like for me personally now, like I never want to stop learning any, you know, period, whether it's music or art or movies or books or whatever. But, you know, musically, I'm overwhelmed right now by the input. I mean, you know, I'm addicted to my phone. And like on Instagram every day, there's like 20 things pop up before I've had my first cup of coffee of guys that are like incredible. And I'm like, it's just, it's almost too much for me to absorb. And I see, like I teach workshops sometimes and I see guys that could be really good players, but they're bouncing all over the place. Mm-hmm. They're bouncing, you know. So for I would, first of all, there wasn't much to, you know, it wasn't like you could just get on the internet and find all this stuff.
No.
So if I would find there were oftentimes when there would be one song on a record that there was either a guitar solo or chord changes or whatever that really, like, I mean, it sounds corny, but literally they resonated like in here, and I would play it over and over and over until I learned it. And I started doing that with Keith Richards and Hendrix,
right,
and then B.B. King a lot. Live at the Regal, really, like,
nice.
And that showed me the that whole part of the guitar playing and music, the vocal quality of the instrument, where you don't have to know 1,000 scales and 1,000 chords. To be that expressive, I mean, I'll take that all day long. I have really no interest in shredding.
Right.
Even though a lot of what I do down at the Saxon, some people might call it that, but I'm always trying to communicate on a visceral level and tap into something spiritual. It's not like regurgitating these scales that I've
practiced. Yeah, your feelings never felt like that. It had to be real for you.
Yeah, so like, and it'd be things like they were all over the map. Like, I got this Norman Blake record, Whiskey Before Breakfast, and it was, you know, just him and a guitar. And, obviously bluegrass, and there was a lot of bluegrass going on down there. And I had a friend that played banjo, and a lot of the stuff was just like, who were my friends, you know? And I had one guy that played banjo, and I had a bunch of other blues guitar player friends. And, we would, you know, hey, have you heard this record or that record? And I mean, I didn't hear the Allman Brothers till I was like a senior in high school.
Really?
And then like within 3 months, I'm in a jamming with two drummers and we're like, I've learned the whole Fillmore East record and everything.
Oh, that record's so good.
The cool thing is that I kind of did the opposite of what a lot of people do. Is like I went B.B. King, Albert King,
yeah,
then the Allman Brothers.
Right.
As opposed to, I like the Allman Brothers. Where did it come from?
Right.
It was the other way around for
right.
me. But like, you know, there was really no, and then there's the absence of the forums that where they tell you what sucks and what you're doing wrong, you know, instead of like what you're doing, like that's cool. And, you know, all this, the governing body of the internet who determines whether or not it's cool or not. And I just went with what I dug. And one day that was a Norman Blake song. And the next day I was learning like a Larry Carlton solo off of a Crusaders record.
Right.
I didn't like the rest of the record, but there were two songs that had this tone and this phrasing. Then he played these solos that was like, and I learned that. And then the next day I found this Dave Edmunds record with Repeat When Necessary.
Uh-huh.
And it had one song on it called Sweet Little Lisa with Albert Lee playing a solo. Yeah. And I was just like, I don't know what he's doing. I got to figure that out. And I spent like a year, I'm not kidding you,
wow,
learning his solo.
I believe it.
I found out about 3 years later that he had this thing on his Telecaster called a B-string bender, where you pull down on the neck and it pulls the B-string up a whole step. That's how he was getting those sounds. So the ignorance is bliss thing applied totally in that situation. You know, like if I had known that, I would have assumed I couldn't play that
right
without a B-string bender. But I didn't know that, but I figured out how to play it without.
Out.
So
that's awesome.
Those little things, you know, and we were just hungry. All my friends and myself, but we were all hungry to find something. You know, the good stuff.
And there were the magazines helped too, like the Rolling Stone and Cream.
Yeah,
and stuff.
I read Rolling Stone and Guitar Player and Cream and Circus. I mean, I live for the next issue of all that
exactly.
stuff. When I found there was a Guitar Player magazine, I mean, I can remember the drugstore I was in and Santana was on the cover. I mean, I can remember that. I was like, they make a magazine about this stuff?
Right. I'm sure you've been in it a lot.
I've been in it a few times.
Yeah.
You know, they're all online now, though. I mean, when's the last time you bought a magazine?
A long time, and I miss magazines.
I get the Oxford American.
Do you?
Yeah, just because for some reason, A, I want to support it, and B, there's a tactile thing about that sort of writing that I like. But beyond that, man, even all the newspapers now, I used to love working the crossword with pencil.
Yeah.
And
just books, if you're reading a book, I don't know, I can't get a Kindle either. You know, people get read books on their phone, and I'm like, I gotta smell the book. I've read books where I actually want to tear the page out and eat it. I like it so much.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I know what you mean.
And with music is the same thing, where you just, oh my God, how do I ingest this?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And you were, that was your whole method from the start. I'm just going to ingest this stuff.
It was. And I mean, you know, ear training meant something back then. That, like, there wasn't tab. There wasn't a place there wasn't a place you go to find all these things written out. You had to just pick the needle up and put it on the record and keep going over and over. And so, I mean, I developed my ear to hear the, you know, intervals between notes. And if I playing a song I don't know and I find what key it's in, I can pretty much play the song.
Right.
I mean, I can write chord charts without a guitar in my hand, you know, and you have to be able to do that in Nashville. But that was the benefit of that environment was, you know, developing your ear. And that's something I think is a little lacking right now. I just don't think the opportunity is there to take advantage of it because it's too easy. It's written out. I get emails all the time. Do you have tab for that?
Uh-huh.
And I mean, I'm like, I just like, no, I'm sorry, I don't. But what I really want to say is do yourself a favor and figure it out on your own. There are not that many chords.
Right.
You'll do yourself a world of good.
My friend Chris Potter is a big Jimmy Page freak, and he's a great guitar player. And I think it's the Rain song that because he would figure everything out by ear too, and he said it took him so long because there was something in the...
It's the tuning.
You know what it is?
Yeah, the guitar's tuned completely different.
Right.
You know, and that's like... Now that is a hard thing. You know, if you didn't see like Jimmy Page playing it...
Right.
That would have been a hard thing for me to figure out. Like, right. I would have read about open tunings, but I forget that might be dadgad or something that wasn't as common. Like open E, G, A, all those tunings. You know, I got a Leo Kottke record, and he was like all in open tunings. And Keith Richards, I figured out. But I also figured out how to fake my way. Before I knew that, you know, instead of tuning to an open G and where the root would have been on this string, I figured out how to fake my way through open tunings. Just where I get the, you know, it's just like little things, you know, and it's, so it becomes part of your style, and your ear develops, and in the process of trying to think, play these things that maybe were in another tuning and you didn't know it, or had a B string bender and you didn't know it, right. Your hands start moving in ways they never would, and so
right, that makes sense. All right, so you go to you get out and you want to get to music school. You do this 5-week thing at Berkeley.
Yeah,
and that proved to be a really cool experience.
Yeah, it was completely eye opening. I mean, the first night I was there, I went down and heard Larry Coryell play solo. And then, you know, the jazz workshop and Paul's Mall were on top of each other. Mm-hmm. And, well, first of all, coming from Louisville to now, this is a town with a scene. You know, there's like for real stuff going on here. And so I went and heard Pat Metheny for a week. Mm. I heard the Dixie Dregs for a week. Mm. I saw Bill Evans play.
Mm. Wow.
Pat Martino. I went to see Pat Martino. His amp blew up in the first set, or was acting up in the first set. And I was like, I went up to him. I said, "Do you need an amp?" And he goes, "Yeah, I really do." And I said, "I'll be right back." And got in my car and went down to the dorm and got my amp. And so I was on the guest list the whole week. And
he
I was like, "Can I take a lesson from you?" He goes, "Yeah, come on over to the hotel." And I still have all the handwritten stuff he wrote out for me. So it was just, I was soaking up all this. And there was a band called Tigers Baku. And they had a guitar player named Bill Frisell.
Uh-huh.
I mean, he was like, you know, 3 or 4 years. I mean, he was young. And so there was all that. And then, so it was being in that town and just seeing the level of, you know, what for like, what really good,
but
how
players.
Good really good people were. It was like,
And you were very much about that because you wanted that.
Yeah, I did. And I always, somehow or other, always seemed to end up in the position where I was the youngest guy around. Mm-hmm. And
were the youngest in your grade?
Yeah, because I mean, my birthday is December 20th. And I went
the 14th.
I went in the first grade. I was 5. And so I finished my first semester of college. I was still 17.
Yeah, exactly.
I was always the youngest guy. Now I'm the oldest guy. It's the weirdest thing. It happened overnight.
It does. It flips fast.
Yeah, it does.
That's a weird thing. I don't even think I want to get into it. I think it's important when you went to Indiana and you met Kenny at that school, because he really kind of, he showed you a more level of professional getting in the game.
Yeah, I went to school. I went to the music school for a year, and it became apparent right off the bat that it wasn't a guitar. There was really no guitar program there. And I met these guys that had all just graduated from the music school, and they were starting a band. And so, okay. And they asked me to join their band, and Kenny was the drummer in the band, and he had just got his master's.
Okay.
And I think most of them had just got their master's. And Indiana's a pretty heavy, you know, it's a very heavy music school.
Right.
So here I am in this band with these guys that have master's degrees from Indiana IU, and I'm just trying to keep up. And but again, you know, we toured, did a lot of touring in the Midwest, and then, I mean, that was really invaluable. And to this day, Kenny and I are super close friends, and we've played on. You know, We went on to work with Mellancamp, and then we played on records together in Nashville, and still end up on stuff to this day.
That's awesome and great that you always get to play with people that not only they're great players, but they're your friends. Yeah,
exactly.
I just want to say quickly my opinion of that. Whenever we wanted to Mellencamp record, that was the one for me of all of his catalog that I thought was the best, solidest of his record. And didn't surprise me to see your name on it. Help him make that guitar tone. I just think it was probably the rockinest of all of them.
Yeah, it was definitely, I mean, that record, you know, he made Lonesome Jubilee, which to me is a masterpiece.
Yeah, but
I think that's his best record.
It probably
personally
is. You're right.
And
but I like Whatever We Wanted because of the guitar.
Well, I went up and played. Then he did Big Daddy, and that's I went up and played on four songs of that record. And when Larry Crane left the band, they just called me and said, "Do you want to be in the band?" I'm like, "Yeah, I want to be in the band." The only thing bad about it was having to tell Joe I was leaving. Right. But Whenever We Wanted was sort of like I was the new guy, and John wanted to make something. After making two sort of mellow records, he's like, and then with, you know, they'd done the last four or five records with the drums in the big room, these huge drum sounds. So they put the drums in the small room and brought the guitar amps out to the big room. And it was just, it's an electric guitar record.
Yes,
I mean,
it is.
It's a slamming electric guitar record. And it was really fun. It was real, real different, you know, being in the band and then doing a record than it was to go up and just play on four songs. So,
sure.
It was a really amazing experience to work with him. You know, I did three years, and we did Big Daddy, and then Whenever We Wanted, and then Human Wheels brought it back to a lot more acoustic, and there was a lot more arranged. And Malcolm Byrne was co-producing a lot of that record, and that was cool to work with him.
Nice, awesome.
But yeah, John in the studio is like, to me, that's where his true His genius is to take these three chord folk songs and
turn them
into
pop songs or whatever,
rock,
charted anthems.
Yeah. So I mean, every song was different. Every day was different, and it was really a great way to make music. He would have the whole band there, and we would he would come in, and the whole band would be there. And he would come in with a song, and he would play it on acoustic. Well, first of all, before he said it. But most of the time, he would say, "Guys, this is the best song I've ever written, and if you fuck it up, I'm going to kill every one of you." I mean, every other song, at least every other song was that. And what that meant was, if it took more than two or three times of playing it, it was ruined.
Oh, wow.
So we paid attention when he played it, you know. And it was before I was writing charts or anything. Uh-huh. I was just, like, memorizing as he played it.
That was some schooling right there.
Yeah, and so we would cut the song, and every time we cut a new song, it would always be a different approach in terms of who went out first. You know, it wasn't always guitar, bass, and drums, and everybody goes out and cuts the song. And then we would finish that song that day. The song would be 90% of the time, the song would be recorded. By the end of the day.
Wow.
And at the end of the day, we would do a rough mix, you know, and we're still on the monitor section of the board, which is like when you mix a record, you got all the big faders down at the bottom. And so we were turning little knobs, and it would sometimes take two or three of us to help make these moves, you know, turn up the guitar solo. Dave, you do that. And inevitably, both those full records that I did with him, I think at least four songs that ended up on the record were those rough mixes. We'd come back in and try to remix, and you couldn't beat the emotion. You couldn't beat the feel of that experience of, like, just take the whole day with one song, the whole band, do all the overdubs, and then do a mix. You could, and, like, you know.
That makes sense.
Every record, three or four songs, it couldn't.
That's super
couldn't
cool.
do better, which really taught me a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
Back away from anything I didn't want to feel. Spent half of a lifetime spinning my wheels till the past caught up with me, wrapped me in its icy chill. I ran away till I had to face all the pain I couldn't kill. Cold wind blows, losing all sensation, letting go of any expectations, learning how to live. your heart begins to shift. Grateful for the gift of desperation. Got real good at flying on the wings of excess. At nights when I light on the soft bed of success, there comes a time you cross a line when you know the game is up. You can swim against the rising tide, let the oceans fill your cup. Cold wind blow, losing all sensation, letting go of any expectations, learning how to live. Your heart begins to shift, grateful for the gift of desperation. The best of luck will always turn, wooden bridges will always burn. The hardest times we find ourselves embracing are the gifts of desperation. Heart begins to shift, grateful for the gift of desperation. Desperation.
You've been on the stage, all the great stages in Austin. Obviously, you've been on great world stages, but Austin, since we're here, it's good to talk about Antone's, obviously, Continental or some of the places. But the Saxon has happy hours that have been really successful over the years, and you have one of those.
Yeah, I mean, I had no idea. The idea of playing at 6 o'clock at night was really foreign to me at sure. first, but I've really grown to love it. And you know, I mean, we play every week that I'm in town, and I'm amazed, like, half the people there come every week.
Right.
And for me, it's just an hour and a half of most nights, like 97% of the time, it's kind of like 90 minutes of a spiritual experience where I'm playing my songs the way I want to play them with incredible musicians who push me and I'm honored to play with.
Right.
And
are they the same every week or do they switch?
No, it rotates a little bit. It rotates. It does rotate. Right now I have three different bass players, and like just before I came over here I was like going through my calendar like I don't know who knows what song, and you know, and I had to cancel some stuff in July because I'm going to Italy to play some shows. And
nice.
I forgot who was lined up for that night and everything. So it gets a little complicated, but it keeps it fresh, too.
Sure. But it's because guys got to earn a living. So they have to play with more than one band if you're a bass player.
Man, the guys that I'm playing with now, they're remind me a lot of me when I first got here. They're a lot younger than me, and they're like, they live and breathe it all day long, and they're
right.
incredible players. You can feel that that excitement and energy in what they're doing, and they work every night. I mean, they play literally, like, these guys are so good that they're working with, and it's a different, stylistically different stuff every night. So it's really, really cool to play with It's like the same songs become completely.
That was like your experience,
like you said. Yeah, the same songs become completely different songs.
Right.
With their interpretation, and when I got good at it pretty quick. I'll honestly say, of honoring each musician and not saying you need to play it like this or play it like the record or do this. Like now, that I think that they're like, "Did you like what I did?" I said, "Man, do what you want to do." I mean, that's really all I ever say, and I think. That's the best way to go. And Joe Ely was like that with me.
Yeah.
He's like, play more. Get up, you know, get on the edge of the stage and go. You know, I mean, like, at first I'd be looking over, like, should I quit my solo now? And he's like, and he'd be egging me on. And, you know, so what a gift that was.
Hell yeah.
And
especially Joe, man.
Yeah. We could talk for more than an hour of just about that experience.
Yeah. I bet, and it'd be a great hour for a conversation too. So having the Saxon there though, and Joe's still running the
Joe Abels, and it's a great room. And Richard Vannoy, the hardest working man in Austin, Austin music, you know, does
Love
sound
Richard.
For three bands a night, and it sounds great on stage. It really, I mean, I just really like the way it sounds up there. I like the room, and it's a, you know, I can be there. I can cut across town at rush hour, and you know, you're not going up from where I'm from where I live. I'm just cutting straight across, and I can get there pretty quick, and I'm home for my my after gig bowl of granola by like 8:15. That's like my traditional
bowl of granola after the gig.
After gig, yeah. No fuss, no muss.
No, milk. Is it milk in the granola or
almond milk, man?
Almond milk. Some people do yogurt, but well, almond milk.
That's for breakfast.
I got you. One of my favorite songs ever is your song "Saki and Venom." And
you mean like ever?
Yeah, I mean literally. Like I played it on. We did a radio show for the Songwriters Across Texas, and I would write them out. And I did a show, and I played that. And I played it next to Sue Foley and I think Bone Crusher. I threw in there, and it was this. And I every time I listened to it, I liked it more. And so I do these late night jam sessions where I just got to have songs, and I got headphones on, and it's loud.
Yeah.
And I'll play that song like seven times in a row, literally.
Man, I don't know that anybody's ever said that.
I mean, it's. I start drooling. Yeah. But you have a fun story behind it.
Well, that song is completely a retelling of what happened the night before I wrote it. I mean, it's easiest song I've ever written.
Yeah.
I just wrote what happened.
Right.
And do you want to know the story?
Yeah, I do.
I was in L.A. Playing with the Dixie Chicks at the time, and had a night off, and I went out to dinner with Billy Gibbons and our tour manager, and we had a really fun time, and I know Billy off and on, and certainly one of my big influences and heroes, and so we'd met before, and I just think the world of him, and I've stolen so much from him over the years.
His tones are so crazy.
I would, especially the first five albums, know, I would see them come through Louisville a lot. I would see them a lot. You know, it's like, you know, the intensity, the way he hit the note, the way he got, you know, the aggression he played with back then and everything was a big thing for me. But anyway, we went out to had Mexican food, and then we went over someplace else and had some drinks. And I'm like, I got to play the next night at the Forum or something. You know, when you kind of want to get some sleep, you know, when you're going to go do that.
Right.
I got the infamous, just one more drink line. You know, have you ever gotten that? It's, you know where that's going.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, it's Billy. I can't say no. Well, we hop in a cab, and we go to this. He goes, I got this great, great spot to show you, and it was a bar called the El Carmen. And we walk in, and it's like a Quonset hut with red and blue lights, really dark. black velvet paintings of wrestlers on all in the wall and the ceiling. I mean, it's like a Quentin Tarantino movie.
Right, right.
And we walk in, and the bartender knows Billy. And I think he was a guy that used to play guitar in Point Blank, you know, the Southern rock band Point Blank. And he told us that. And so all of a sudden, one more drink turned into, like, you know, sample of the finest tequilas we've got. It was basically a tequila bar. So I'm like, I need to eat something. So I get the menu, and the menu is like 8 pages of tequila, and then 1 page on the back that says, like, nachos. that was the menu for the place. So this guy is, like, you know, dumping these, like, you know, I don't know, $70 shot. This is right before I decided I needed to pull the reins back on all that. Anyway, so he sensed, I could tell we were there, and it was, like, getting really late, and we were making motions about leaving, and he sensed that he was losing our attention. So he pulled out the big guns, and he reaches down underneath the bar, and he's kind of struggling a little bit, and he pulls and just pounds this thing on the bar, and it's one of those, like, industrial mayonnaise, you know, or pickle jars, and it's full of some sort of murky liquid, and there's a cobra in there, coiled up, you know, obviously
cobra
no longer with us
in a jar.
And I'm like, and even Billy was like, got the camera out immediately. We were like, what do you do with that? And he goes, well, you can drink it. And I said, well, is it safe? And he goes, usually. And he said, it's $1,500 to open the jar. And I mean, like, and I said, what is it? And he said, oh, man, it ain't nothing but sake and venom. And I'm like, in my cloudy phase, I'm just like, dink, you know, that little something that you get. It's like the clock when the thing turns. It was like that little, it's some, the gear shifted into this next slot, and I was like, title. And well, they get the cobra to, they inject its venom into, they fill it with sake,
right?
And then they get the cobra to
put its venom in there,
and apparently it's like got hallucinatory, and it comes from Vietnam. And it's probably not sanctioned by the California ABC.
I'm guessing not.
And anyway, that was that night. And I woke up the next morning in the hotel in West Hollywood, and I had a guitar in the room. And I wrote this song in like 15 minutes. It's not like it's genius, but it's, I mean, you can't write songs if you don't get out, you know?
Yeah. Exactly.
If you don't have anything to write about.
But I love it when anything comes just and then it's done. Like, there, for me, with writing, many things that can come out in a draft, you got to fix them, you know, on some level. There aren't that many that just come out right and you don't touch them.
And it was on a Tuesday, and, you know, I'm hanging with Billy, so instead it's not Blue Monday, it's Blue Tuesday.
Right, right.
So I'll play it for you. I mean, if I can remember it. Cruising down to El Carmen, black velvet wrestling tequila heaven. Yeah, they got a little something ain't on the menu. If you wanna get behind the wall of voodoo, a cobra snake in a jar. Yeah, cloudy brown liquid. Forget where you are. Sake and venom, sake and venom. It's an old time Vietnam recipe. Past hate.
hand to hand down the family tree. Gotta take it real slow, a little dab will do ya. Yeah, speed and light get to buzzing right through ya. But we're snake in a jar. Yeah, cloudy brown liquid. Forget where you are. Sake and venom, sake and venom. You got two choices when it comes to the table. Plain unfiltered, a ginger root for extra flavor. A cobra snake in a jar. Yeah, cloudy brown liquid. Forget where you are. Sake and venom, sake and venom. Cobra snake in a jar. Cloudy brown liquid. Forget who you are. Sake and venom, sake and venom. Sake and venom, sake and venom. Sake and venom.
Bravo. Bravo. Bravish.
Thank you for playing that, man.
I'm happy to accommodate.
You did great, man. It's all the time we got. I appreciate you coming on the show so much, David.
Thank you for having me.
And if y'all have been watching this on the CW, there's a longer version on our YouTube channel. Just go to Songwriters Across Texas on YouTube. There's also some other episodes up there you might like. And then David, I'm sure, has a website.
I do. And it's funny, it's davidgrissom.com.
Go figure. davidgrissom.com. Go there and get that sake and venom, baby. Once again, my pleasure, David.
Thank you for having me.
All right.